kind of different sitars that he's brought here today to our exhibit. And he's going to play us a couple of pieces. He talked about maybe playing something that's more historical, and then talking about how it's leading into some of this contemporary music and how we're seeing the sitar start to emerge in different areas. So, he's with the Sharma.
Thank you, friends, for joining us this afternoon. We are here. I'm here to. I'm very honored that Joshua has brought me here to speak about sitar, and he has complete belief on me, so I am here. We talk about sitar. If you go back into the history of the sitar, the origin of sitar has many different theories which musicians and musicologists they follow. Some of them say that it was this instrument was designed by Amir Khusro, who came from Iran, Persia. When he came to India, he designed to the Indian subcontinent, he designed the sitar. And some musicologists, they believe that the sitar already existed, which was called Tritantri Veena. And Tritantri Veena was a Vedic instrument. It's a Vedic instrument. It's a form of Veena derived from Saraswati Veena. Saraswati, goddess Saraswati, you must have seen the idol goddess Saraswati, the Veena. That's the Saraswati Veena. So all the string instruments in our Hindu mythology, we believe that all the string instruments come from Saraswati Veena, which is the mother of all string instruments. So sitar is one of them. And it was called Tritantri Veena because it has three strings and a plucking instrument. And it had about 14 frets first, and then it was added on 17th, and then it was added on 24 frets. Then when we speak about Amir Khusro, some musicologists, they say that Amir Khusro, when he saw this Tritantri Veena, the first string, which is the main playing string, okay? So it's on the left hand side, it's starting from here, okay? The Tritantri Veena, the first string was on the other side, it was reversed. So what he did was he modified the arrangement of the string. So he bring the first string from here, from right to left, and accordingly the scale. And then in the Veena, if you have seen Veena, where the frets are fixed, it's just like guitar, where the frets, you cannot move the frets. So similarly, the Veena also has the same fret arrangement. But here what he did, another modification was tying the frets so that you can move the frets from this note, okay, from this note to this note. So these two modifications he majorly did in Tritantri Veena, and he started calling it Seher Tar. Seher means three again in Persian language, and Tar means the string. So Seher Tar, after Seher Tar was developed, then musicians, they researched and developed, and many developments happened in the sitar. And finally, people started calling it sitar. So the strings added to the sitar was, before we did not have the sympathetic strings at all in the sitar. There were only main strings, so three main strings, then came four main strings, then five, six, and then seven. So the maximum you have seven strings, main strings on sitar. And for the sympathetics, a musician thought of, you know, these sympathetic strings, because sarangi originally had sympathetic strings. So sarangi, he saw the sarangi instrument and he thought, you know, why not use the sympathetic strings on sitar? The similar to get the harmonics, to get the overtones. When you're playing the main string, you can hear the sympathetic strings now. I'll just demonstrate. If you hear the extra sound, so this is what the sympathetic strings they do. It is like when you're playing the bass note. So the next octave sympathetic string is vibrating also. So you get the, it's like an orchestra. Like for example, you have violin, you have cello to create that harmonics, and then you have the double bass. So it's created in one instrument. And then we have in sitar we have this, if you see this flat bridge. Usually in the other instruments you have seen, it's a saddle bridges, like in guitars, violin, and any other Indian instruments like sarod or dilruba or esraj or any other instruments, you will see all the saddle bridges on it. You don't see any flat bridges like this. So only sitar, veena and tanpura has the flat bridges. So what is a flat bridge, what it does? This creates a natural reverb and delay effect in the instrument. If we have a saddle bridge, we will not have that effect. In the West, if we compare to the Western instruments, when the guitar effects are used, you outsource them through gadgets. Like effects, you have the delay panel, you have the distortion panel, you have the wah-wah panel, you have the reverb, you have different effects. But so we are talking about the delay and the reverb effect over there. So the delay and reverb effect you get from this bridge. So we don't need any extra gadget to have that effect. We naturally get the reverb effect on the sitar. You have the sustain, you have the delay, you have the reverb in it. Now the popularly styles of playing the sitar, there are two popularly styles of playing the sitar, there are different schools, or you call it gharana, or a family of musicians following a tradition. That's called the gharana. There is Vilayat Khani gharana and the Mahir gharana. Mahir gharana, the famous Pandit Ravi Shankar, you know, he followed that gharana, and we call it the Pandit Ravi Shankar style, or the Mahir gharana, or Imdad Khani gharana, or the Vilayat Khani gharana. So there are two schools of playing. This particular sitar is the Vilayat Khan style sitar. Here we have six strings, six main strings. So basically you are playing the two chords on the frets. You are fretting the two chords. And the other four chords are tuned to like a open chords, which you keep strumming and you get the chord. It's the feel of a minor chord or a major chord. Suppose you want to do major chord. Now it's the major chord key. But if you want to do minor, so it has become minor now. So this is how you tune the main strings on the Vilayat Khan style sitar. And then it has 12 sympathetic strings, 11 to 12 sympathetic strings. So the moment you strike the strings, the listener will know that it's the Vilayat Khan style sitar. And the Ravi Shankar style sitar. As you can see, the look is similar to Veena, which is like it has a very traditional look, you know. And it has a second gourd, as you can see, this small thing here, this round thing, and it's hollow. Here, the main strings is 7, and you are fretting 4 strings here. You get the lower register strings also here, and you have the extra bass octave compared to the sitar. For the bass strings to sound good, we need to make the size of the sitar also bigger compared to the other sitar.
Do they have different names? Are they both called sitar?
They're both called sitars, but the two different styles.
Or a bass or, yeah. Okay, just
so here. You can hear the harmonics. Produced by the sympathetic chords. Feel in this sitar, and what does this the second gourd or a tumbi, it's called a tumbi, second gourd of the sitar does is the sound delay effect, natural delay effect when you're playing the bass strings. So the bass strings are mostly played on the first 4 or 5 frets. After effect, you get the natural delay effect immediately in this sitar. And the first 2 strings are similar to the other sitar. The rest of the 3 chords is again open chord, which is tuned to the 5th and the octave and octave. Sitars, most of the time, the musicians, they tune the sitar to C sharp or D. I have tuned the sitars right now to D key, and accordingly to a different scale. If I'm playing a minor scale or a major scale, depends, you know, which scale. Then accordingly I'll tune the sympathetic strings. Here we have sympathetic strings in number 13, which has more than the other sitar. So to have more option of tuning. You can do that option also over there, but basically the school of playing here, they prefer the 13 sympathetics and 7 main strings, as I've told you. The first string is tuned to, suppose if I'm tuning it to D, the first string will be G, open, D, A, low A, low D, A, D, and D. So basically it's a open tuning. You are playing more of melodies on sitar rather than playing more of chord system. You can play triad, like these kind of triads, but not a, the whole chord like you do it on guitars. not on sitar. So it's more of a melody based, like a lead instrument. So more like a lead instrument.
Are the notes that people would read on paper, are they the same as we have in Western guitar music?
Yes. Same. But here we don't read the music and play. Here it's more of improvising. You have a fixed melody, like on a scale or a raga or rag you play. Suppose it's a morning raga or like this time raga you're going to play. I'm going to perform a little bit of one piece so that you'll have the idea how the sitar is, the tradition way of playing the sitar, the pieces we play with the drums and without the drums, how the presentation is done by a musician on a particular raga. So we don't read the music and play. It's more like, you know, it's mindset, and we have spontaneous, we do spontaneous improvisations. Only on those notes. We don't, suppose we take a minor raga, minor chord raga, where we will not improvise and go to a major scale. We'll just stick to that minor scale and keep improvising on it. And we do it kind of spontaneous melodies and spontaneous improvisations, and then do the performance. You can compare it to jazz. Jazz, you do like that, not in Western classical music. Western classical music is already the scores are done, and then you just follow and play what is written on the sheet. And the values of the notes you have to give in particular phrases. So that is all written there. So it's all being composed by the composer, and then the orchestra performs on it. So that's a different setup. The jazz is a different setup. The rock is a different setup. So similarly, we also have a different setup. The Indian classical music is mostly compared by the jazz music most of the time. But the only difference between the jazz and the Indian classical music would be, as I told you, we just improvise on that similar, same, whatever scale we choose, we will just kind of improvise only on that scale, not jump to the other scale and then come back to the main melody you're playing on the minor scale.
Are all sitars made of the same wood?
Yeah, we have two different kind of woods we use most of the time. The most of the time, like 70-75% sitars are made from cedar wood. Oh. Or there's another option, teak wood. Teak was another option. Like this sitar is made from teak wood. And similarly, the same style sitar can be made from a cedar wood. This sitar is from cedar wood. So similarly, we can get sitars made from teak wood of this style too. So I'll just play a small piece if you allow me to.
Thank you.
raga is called Miyagi Todi, which is played during this time of the day, and starting from morning to afternoon, and then the time zone changes, and then we have different melodies for that zone. So the scale goes like this. So musician going to start playing the sitar, presenting the raga by playing the first piece called as ala, which is without the drums, and it's just like an introductory to the listener to tell them that this is the raga I'm going to play. So there are different phrases he's going to play as I'll play. The first piece is called ala, then the second piece is with the beats but without the drums, it's called the jor, and then jhala piece, and then the drum comes in first, these down tempo, which is called the vilambit gat. It's the melody, this a slower melody, and then improvise on it, and then the next piece is the drut gat, which is the faster tempo, and then eventually the jhala with the drums, and then the climax, and then that's the end of the performance. So I'm doing the jhala first. Oh, sorry, the ala. Thank you. So I'm going to play with the tabla now. the Lama Temple. Before we cross the temple one.
Thank you.
Yep, so...